Yeah, so preparing for this talk, I have to admit I'm a little bit more nervous than I normally am because I've talked quite a lot about Soccermatics the last year, and I've talked to various book festivals, and there the audience tends to be people who are interested in math, and they have a passing interest in football as well, and they're not really total experts on the subject, but it feels here, I know a lot of the people in the audience work a lot with data and know a lot about how data works, and I'm sure that you're going to have lots of interesting questions for me afterwards. So I'm going to do this in a way that we have this joke in maths about when we give a seminar, and when you give a seminar in maths, the first third should be understandable by everybody, the second third should be understandable by the people who really know all of the details of how things work. And then the last third is only understandable by the speaker himself. So I'm going to take at least the first two thirds of that approach, but I'm not going to do the final bit with the one third. So I'm going to start talking about the key ideas in Soccermatics, or where Soccermatics came from, because I think it's quite fun to tell a little bit about the history of it. Then I'm going to talk about what was included in the new two chapters of the book, which was really, once I'd finished the first version, I found out about all the other work that people were doing on Twitter and so on. And also, I got contacted by quite a few clubs and media things, and I found out a lot more about how data is used in football. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that, and then I'm going to tell you a little bit about what else I've been working on since then. But I think it's really important I show you some pictures of animals and what my normal work looks like. So before I wrote Soccermatics, this was the sort of things that I looked at. I was interested in collective animal behavior, how groups of animals move together. And so at the top left-hand corner, you've got ants there making a pheromone trail. Here we've got some fish that are escaping when we frighten them. This is an experiment we did on cicada calling. So every circle that comes up there is the volume of a calling cicada. We're interested in how waves of sound go through the group. We've got locusts, chickens, pigeons. There's another ant trail there. I looked at sheep and sheepdogs. And this little one here is one of my favorite experiments. It's called prawns in a bucket. What we did is we studied in immense detail how prawns moved around in a bucket when you put them in. It was really to find out how animals cope with traffic jams. And we have a really detailed explanation of that now. We also study humans. This is a study of applause. So after a talk, people start applauding, and there's a kind of contagion of applause that goes through the audience. There's also contagion when people look up. We did experiments where we had people looking up and then we watched other people going past. What was the chance of them looking up when we had different sizes of groups? We recently had a paper on mosh pits and heavy metal concerts. So how people interact in a mosh pit and what type of shapes are formed by that. So, I mean, I think I have the most wonderful job that I study all these different animal groups and try and work out how they work together. But then it's worth saying that, well, where was football in my life before Soccermatics? And I can't resist showing you my own team. This is Uppsala EF Noll Fem. We're the black team who've got the ball all the time, of course. And my son is the one who's offside. Well, there's no offside in this. He's the one that's just run over there. But this is the kids team that I train. And that's taken up a lot of my free time. And when I was watching them play, then I started to think a little bit in mathematical terms about it. I started to think about the triangles you have to create in play. And you'll see that we're an incredibly possession-heavy team. I think that the goal is an irrelevant object in a football match at this age. That basically they should just be passing around the ball, and maybe later we can introduce the goal. So what I did, sometimes I'd make these passing networks. connecting up the players, showing how they connected with each other. And I'd use talk about triangles with them and so on. So I took a little bit of my mathematics into my football training. And so then I wanted to write a popular science book. Now, I think all of this stuff is fascinating. I think it's really, really fascinating. And so I wrote to an agent in London, and he's sitting there, Chris, and I told him all about these amazing, fascinating examples of collective animal behavior. But I also wrote a little bit about football in my example, because it was one of the examples I took in. And Chris said, forget the animals, get rid of them. Nobody's interested in them. The only thing they're interested in is the football. Can't you write more about the football instead? And it was through that that Soccermatics was born. I think his advice was, I think there's still an interesting story to be told about animals, but I think the advice was very good because there was lots of things that I could think about that was mathematical in football. And that was the birth of Soccermatics. The idea I wanted to get across was that you can use mathematics in all types of different ways, and football is one of the perfect examples. Now, to illustrate this, I'll take one of the chapters of the book, and if you've already read the book, you'll know about this chapter, which is how slime molds built Barcelona. I thought that you might be interested to see, if you've read the book, you probably haven't seen what a slime mold looks like. And so this yellow thing here is a slime mold. The middle there, that's meant to be central Tokyo. And the white things here are cornflakes laid out as the suburbs around Tokyo. And the task for the slime mold is to build a network which connects up all of these cornflakes or all of these oat flakes. And you'll see after some time of exploring and moving around, it's built this really perfect network, or a very nice network, very nice triangular structures that connect up different parts of the map. And what Toshi Nakagaki, who did these experiments, found was that slime mold would build networks that were just as good as the human networks. And he did this test in Tokyo. He did it for the German railway network, same result. Slime molds in humans were just as good. Then he did it for the French railway network, same result again. The slime molds found the good solution that the French came up with. Then he did it for the British rail network. And the result was that the slime molds found a much better connection than the British engineers have found. But slime molds are very smart, but they don't have any intelligence. They're just amoeba, but they produce these beautiful networks. And so, of course, Barcelona players are smarter than slime molds. But when I started to think about this, I started to think, well, what are the parallels here? Of course, there's no slime on the pitch. But what there is a network of play. So this is Lionel Messi, of course. And I think before I started thinking seriously about football, I would just concentrate on Messi's run here, and it is an amazing run. But what's very interesting is actually to look at Xavi and Pedro and how they move. What they do is that they move into space the whole time. They try to position themselves as far away from the defending team as possible. And then you can actually build up the network of their positions. And so this is two diagrams from the book. And what this is called, this is called a Voronoi diagram, and the top one is called the De Looney triangulation. And it turns out that by moving into space, what Xavi does is he moves into a maximum distance from the defending players. And by doing that, he simultaneously builds a triangular network that they can pass the ball around. And so there's a very nice property of moving into space, which means that you build triangles. And it's the same with the slime mold. They're moving into space and they end up building triangles. And Barcelona move into space and they end up building triangles. First, Xavi builds a lovely triangle with Messi. Then a few seconds later, Pedro is in a much tighter position, but he again just moves into the center of where all the other players are, and he builds this lovely triangle that he can pass a 1-2 with Messi. And what I realized, and I know lots of you have realized this long time ago, is that a lot of what is happening on the football pitch is not about the individual players with the ball, it's the players who are moving into space and creating these types of triangular structures. Now that was just one example. So the book, the first version of the book, which came out, was full of all different types of things. I think my challenge as a mathematician was really to take everything that I knew about mathematics and apply it to football. And so there's lots and lots of different interesting areas of mathematics. There's randomness, so I started with this famous Paul Gascoigne quote that I never predict anything, and I never will.
It's fascinating. Unpredictable arrival. You better run to the back.
Then I looked at, I had a chapter, Check My Flow, which was all about passing heat maps. I have a chapter called Toto Cyber Dynamo, which is all about a team becoming more than the sum of its parts. I think we saw a bit of that last night with Barcelona. I had a chapter on the world in motion, which is about it's about a lot of these analysis tools for looking at how teams synchronize with each other. I look at the crowd. I have a chapter, You'll Never Walk Alone, which is, it starts with the idea of applauding individuals and the spread of applause. And it also talks about spread of chanting. I had to do, as Zlatan Ibrahimovic, living in Sweden, I had to have a chapter just dedicated to looking at him and his amazing goal against England. And I use that to talk about Newton's equations. I look at game theory and 3 points for the brain managers. I look at something called wisdom of the crowds, where I explain why the odds are so difficult to beat. And then I had to do this thing, so at the end, so when I told people about football and mathematics, they would say, oh, well, it's not, you know, what's the connection? What can you actually use the maths for? And I'd say, well, you know, Barcelona, they have these Voronoi diagrams. And they say, yeah, that's all really nice, but what can you use it for? And I'd say, well, yeah, but there's this randomness thing, and, you know, you can describe randomness. And they'd say, oh, but what can you use it for? And I eventually realized what they meant is, how do you make money using mathematics? So, and I had to prove that it was possible to make money. And so in the end, I put my own money where my mouth was and managed to make, I think, 100 quid in the end from a 400 quid investment over 3 months. So it took a long time, but I managed to make a bit of money using mathematical models. The thing I hate to mention about this is I had this control experiment where my wife was giving some money, and she was meant to be like the, you know, the average punter, and she made more money than I did percentage-wise on her bet. So I gloss over that a bit, but and hers wasn't statistically significant. There's still a lot of arguments about this at home, actually. So I wanted to do all of these different parts of mathematics and educate them by using football examples. And there's lots of non-footballing examples in the book as well. I did manage to get, I snuck quite a lot of collective animal behaviour and other types of things in there while the publishers weren't looking at it. Okay. And it was lots of fun to write. And then what happened is that after I'd finished writing Soccermatics, then I went to the OctoPro forum and presented there. I talked to quite a lot of different people from clubs. I met a lot of the people who are sitting in this room on Twitter and had discussions about analysis things. So there was all these kind of new things that came up for me. So I'd researched the book pretty much by myself. And now there was lots of new ideas that came. And 442 were very nice. I got in contact with Colm, who you mentioned, with StatZone. Colm was very nice to, well, I don't know, the Octa people are here. Anyway, yeah, somehow, yeah, I won't go into that story, but somehow, and in the end, Octa agreed to allow me to use the data in the book, so that was really nice of them. And I got to write a few articles for 442, where I applied some of these ideas. And what I really felt I wanted to do, because of all these experiences, I wanted to write a couple more chapters which said a bit more about how clubs use mathematics, and also how analysts who are working pretty much in their spare time, how what methods they might use and how we might improve things in clubs. Now, just to give you some idea of the state of how things are in clubs just now, what I found talking to a lot of analysts was that there was very limited opportunities to get statistics into the clubs. So this is both talking to Omar Chowdhury, who works for 21st Club, and Rory Campbell, who works for West Ham. And Omar said it very nicely, that the problem with working with managers, coaches and players is that because tenures are so short, they're always focused on the next game. So it's often that managers are interested in things. If you put a Voronoi diagram in front of a manager or a passing network, they're quite interested in those things, but they've got to focus on getting results on Saturday. So it's very difficult for them to incorporate that type of thing into their work. So what Omar does at 21st Club, for example, is try to get these more statistical ideas into the boardroom. And then Rory Campbell was talking about the process of signing players. West Ham sign and sell a lot of players, so he should know about it. But one of the problems is that the whole process of recruitment, you can do all of this nice stats in recruitment, but the whole process is really the wrong way around at many clubs. Recruitment's often initiated by an agent, and the clubs are then simply reacting to that. So they're not going out and using statistics to find their ideal player. They're being told by agents, these are the players that are available to us. So there's all sorts of real-world problems in using statistics for scouting, which can't be addressed by mathematics. But where is scouting at? Where is maths actually used? Now, probably you can't read this at the back, but one analyst I talked very much about this idea of spreadsheet scouting. So that's really, for many clubs, that's the state of the art, is spreadsheet scouting. And this was basically how Kante was found. If you sort a spreadsheet on interceptions, then Kante will be top of that spreadsheet on interceptions. And then he's the player that you buy, because he's the one who's doing the most interceptions. And that's a lot of the clubs are looking at, like, League One or League Two in France, for example, and just counting to see who's top of these spreadsheets. And it's quite interesting that when Steve Walsh, who signed Kante originally, the first thing he did at Everton was sign Garner from Aston Villa, because Garner was number two on the spreadsheet of interceptions. So obviously he was the next best player. And actually, if you look at the stats, he's doing really well at Everton, so he is a good signing. So there's a degree to which that type of spreadsheet scouting really does work. But what can you do that's more sophisticated? Now, I talked to quite a lot of Premier League clubs, but I didn't manage to infiltrate the top clubs, I have to admit. So, well, the one club which is very well known for having bought the company Stats DNA is Arsenal. So I had quite a lot of email exchange with Sarah Rudd, who works for Arsenal, trying to persuade her to do an interview for the book. But she was very nice, but in the end wouldn't do an interview for the book. But luckily, before Stats DNA got bought by Arsenal, they made this lovely video, which you can find online, of Sarah explaining how a lot of the ideas work. And whether they use that now, I don't know. They probably use something slightly more advanced. But there's this very nice technique, which is based on something called a Markov chain. And often people refer to it now as goal chains. And the idea is this, that if you've got the ball in midfield, there's a 25% chance it stays in midfield in the next 5 seconds, for example. There's a 10% chance it goes out to the wing, 20% chance it goes into the box, 5% chance that you score a goal from that thing. These aren't real numbers, they're for illustration. And you can write down all of the different transitions from different areas of the pitch, from one area to the other. And you can build up this thing called a Markov chain, which explains how likely it is for the ball to move from one place to another. And this can be a really good tool for evaluating players, because if you have a player, there's a much better chance of scoring if you have the ball in the box. So if you have a player who's often getting the ball into the box, then they're increasing the probability of scoring. If you have a player who's always taking the ball from midfield out to the wing, they're actually decreasing the probability of the team scoring on average. And that gives you a nice way of evaluating for different parts of the pitch what's the probability of scoring. Now, this is an incredibly oversimplified model, and if you watch Sarah's video, she goes into a more detailed model with more states, but that's a basic way of breaking down the game of football into states. So that was one thing that I write about in quite a lot of detail in the book, and I'm actually going to come back to this idea of goal chains later. The other thing I wanted to investigate more was geometry. So I wanted to think about, because geometry is a very important, geometry is lovely in mathematics, and I did a lot of reading and I got in contact with René Maric, who works for RB Salzburg for their junior club, and he's written a very nice series of blog articles, very mathematical actually, about how the geometry of different things work. And he wrote a very nice article about half spaces. This is the left half space and the right half space, and why, from a geometrical point of view, it's good to find yourself in a half space. And the basic argument is this, that if you're a player here in the half space, you have a better field of vision over what's happening. It's important what's happening here on the pitch, because this is where this player's running in and so on. So while if you're straight on and you can just see in front of you, you don't have as wide a view of the important areas. So one of the reasons for utilizing this half space is that you can see a wider area of the pitch. There's several other reasons, and one of them comes down to, because it was Guardiola who started emphasizing this half space, one of it is that if you're playing against 4-4-2, if you're in the half space in the spacing of 5, then you're actually maximally distant from the opposition. And this is somehow, I like this idea of the evolution of tactics. And so Guardiola's Barcelona team, which I showed at the start, the 2010-11, and I know that Michael Cox is here, knows a lot about this, and has written some very nice articles about the evolution here from Guardiola 4-3-3. And then the evolution really is, well, all you have to do in order to defend against this is you get everyone to tighten up into the middle. Then you've got a 5-meter distance to the attacking players. And then a lot of what Guardiola did at Bayern Munich, from a geometrical point of view, was stretching things out again. So you can actually overload having on the left and the right, and you can have a striker running in. And again, it's a geometric argument about how you should occupy space. So there's these beautiful geometric arguments about the certain different formations and different. Now the question really is, when you start to get into this detailed geometry, is how are analytics going to do this? Because you certainly can't see this directly in Opta data. You can't see this in the ball data. You start to need the type of tracking data that Dan was talking about. But even then, this is not what it actually looks like on a football pitch. I mean, if all the players stood in these lovely formations, it would be really easy for us mathematicians, but there's a lot of movement and there's a lot of repositioning. Tactics are more complicated than this. So I'm just going to say a few things that I think people are starting to do which are useful. This is one of my favorite methods which you can use directly from the Opta data. What I show here is, for the first half of this season, who were making the key passes 30 seconds before there was a good shot on goal. And a good quality shot on goal, I take as some sort of danger area here in the middle. So the size of the player is the number of good quality shots that he's had. And the thickness of the lines are the number of passes made in the 30 seconds leading up to a good shot. And this is quite a lot of information to take in, but I think it tells you a lot about who are the key players in actually creating attacking chances. And there you actually see Kante is very
important in this, as is Matic, of generating a lot of the passes which generate things. And of course, Hazard this season is off the charts with number of connections to the other players. Pedro actually had a lot less connections. He played a little bit less at this point. But you can get an idea about who's actually generating the dangerous chances on different passes. Another approach I like, and this is what a lot of the people at Huddle are trying to do, is looking at the geometry of passing alternatives. So this was a pass by Albrighton to Vardy in the match against Liverpool the other night. And you can actually see what I'm trying to represent here is this is where Albrighton is. And the red areas are areas which are blocked and by a defender and not possible to make a pass. I'm not accounting for player movement too much here or at all. But you can see that he kind of makes this very nice pass through to Vardy here, because there's just that small area that he can get it through. And this type of thing is very good for evaluating player decision making. That was a very good decision on the part of Albrighton in this case. But in more complicated situations, there might be decisions that players have missed. The coach can go over with them and show what sort of passing shadows they neglected or where they could have actually played the ball. Then I think ultimately, this type of analysis is really lovely. As Dan said, much of the data about Premier League we can't use and show, but this data is from a Nuremberg second reserves match, and they're playing left to right on the pitch. And so the pitch markings are because they're playing on half the pitch. It's 8 against 8. And what you can see here is that when the team is defending, the yellow team is defending, the green lines show that they're highly synchronized in their movements. And that tends to be a pattern which, well, it's a clear pattern. When you're defending, you want to move around as a unit. And you can imagine a situation where you can maybe find a player who's not synchronized and is breaking the synchrony, and you can actually say, talk to that player afterwards and say, well, you weren't quite as synchronized as you should have been when you were defending. So these are the types of tools that sometime, possibly in the distant future, clubs will be using to find out if their off-the-ball movement of their players is up to scratch. Yeah, I don't know. This was something I dreamed up. Ryan made me make something like this for the Opta Pro Forum, illustrating how these types of things can be implemented in clubs. But I think the point I wanted to make about this is that I don't think that it should just be the scouts that are somehow gathering all the statistical information. In my ideal world, is that a lot of this information should be integrated into the club, and it should even be consumed at the level of the player. Now, players are sometimes not thought to be the smartest of people, but this is actually it's just not true, actually. So there's been experiments done on football players, and when it comes to spatial intelligence, and mathematical intelligence, they tend to be much better than the average person in the street. And so I feel that a lot of the type of geometrical information, they're much able to understand. And if you just watch a match with a professional football player, their ability to think about the geometry of the game is much greater than the average person's ability to think about the geometry of the game. So I really feel that if you're going to do this analytics thing properly, you're actually going to be talking to the managers, you're going to be talking to the players, and all of them have to buy in to this type of geometrical approach to football. That's a long, long way off, but I do think it's a possibility. Now, I said I'd finish after 30 minutes, I've got 3 minutes left. So I'll tell you one last thing. And so what happened after Soccermatics Pro, because I'm doing one more project now, or I'm quite getting into this project, is I'm working with a company called 12, and we're going to make a fantasy football computer game based on Opta on-the-ball data. And the idea is that live during the match, you can see if your favorite players are making good passes, bad passes, and see what they're doing during the match. And so if I take, for example, and this is based on the Markov chains thing. So this is a sort of basic expected goals model. This was Zlatan's best shot in this particular match, which didn't go in. And the colours there are the value of shots that he had at different parts of the pitch. The darker the area, the better the quality of the shots. So this is a kind of expected goals model. Then you can also look at TAC. This is the value of particular passes that he's made during the match. Darker is better passes that he's made. This was the best pass that he made from here into the area in front of the box. Very high value pass. And you can also look at defense. You can look at where did he recover the ball. And this was the best area where he recovered the ball. And then again, the darker the area, the better the quality of the recovery of the ball. Now, I think that this works quite nicely. We can basically quantify players in terms of shots, attack, defense, and the mistakes they make, like missing and doing, getting yellow cards or performing fouls. And so we've been looking at this recently. So this was for last night's match, Barcelona's ranking. And so blue is attack, red is defense, green is shots and goals, and yellow is mistakes. And this is ranking for the best to worst player in the Barcelona team. I think I'd agree that Neymar was pretty much up there for that match. Messi was very good, Suarez was very good. And then it becomes a little bit more subjective around this area, but that's the statistical ranking of the best players in the match. It's a little bit unfair on Ter Stegen because he didn't have very much to do to call him the worst player in the game, but statistically, he didn't have much to do, then he just let in a goal. So statistically, he was the worst player in the game.
Well, for the second goal, though.
Sorry? Yes, he did. I mean, our model did not account for that happening. There's a lot of things that the model doesn't work for. And then PSG they were really dismal. And then they come across as being extremely dismal. Cavani got a goal, and that's worth 100 points in our system. Because if you've scored a goal, it's worth 100 points. But basically, everyone else was pretty dismal. And I don't know, it's much of a muchness, really. But it's quite important that these things work for other teams. So I also did it for the Man City-Stoke City match. And I watched the Barcelona match. I don't know if there's anybody who watched this match, actually. But it turns out that, because it's important that it's not just the strikers and the attacking midfielders who always do well in a system like this. And so it works quite well that Kolarov and Fernandinho did a good job, because it was really I didn't see the match, but I think that Aguero, he's right at the bottom here, missed a lot of chances, and they didn't really create many expected goals either. So this system seems to work not just for the attacking midfielders and give them points. And then Stoke City, Ryan Shawcross was the best player, very good defending, massive red defence bar, Jonathan Walters as well. And so you can actually manage to get some ranking. And of course, I don't think that this is the final ranking of these players. It's the statistical ranking based on the increased and decreased probability of scoring. But it's a nice system. Now, I hoped we'd actually be able to let you download this and start playing around with it. Because what we need now is a bunch of sort of geeky football nerd data science types to tell us where our system is complete bullshit and where it actually works. And so I think Dan's going to hopefully send round maybe next week a link so anybody who'd like to play it and watch a game can start to beta test this this system and see how well it works. But with that, I'll just show you another picture of Soccermatics and say thank you very much.